Welcome to A Photographer's Life, the channel that takes you behind the curtain into the world of professional architectural photography. Join us now for an episode with one of America's premier architectural photographers. Today's broadcast comes from a recent interview with award-winning American architectural photographer, Lincoln Barbour. Today's interview was conducted by AIAP Director Alan Blakely. We hope you enjoy the show. If you do, please let us know by liking this episode and subscribing to this channel. Now, on with the show.
All right, we'd like to welcome you to this episode of A Photographer's Life, brought to you by the AIAP. Today, we're talking with Lincoln Barbour, an architectural photographer out of Portland, Oregon. And Lincoln, it's a pleasure to welcome you here. Thank you for coming on with us on this podcast episode.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
For those of you who don't know Lincoln's work, Lincoln's one of the elite photographers in the United States with regard to architectural photography. So we're really pleased to have him on here and hope that we can learn a lot about his career and what makes him successful. So Lincoln, to start out with, I'm just curious to know, where did your interest in photography start?
My dad was a wedding and portrait photographer when I was a kid. So I kind of grew up in his studio and was around photography a lot. But I didn't really discover photography until high school. I took a black and white photo class. And
Okay. Yeah,
this is back in 92. So back in the film days.
Yeah.
And I just loved photography, but I didn't know how to make a living at it. So I moved into graphic design and web design in the late 90s.
Okay.
And then still did photography as a hobby, but it wasn't a career idea for me at the time. Mm-hmm. And then I did a website for an architectural photographer, a guy named Philip Beaurline, based in Charlottesville, yeah. Virginia.
Yeah.
And he was the first photographer that I ever met that didn't shoot weddings and portraits. And I just kind of, he opened up my idea to this whole commercial photography world. And, you know, it's funny, before I met him, you know, or looking at an ad in a magazine, like I would just assume the company had photographers on staff that made those photos. So I didn't realize there was this whole freelance world, you know, shooting photography. So, I was kind of like, I was worked in the web design area, like during the first .com bubble.
Okay.
And I really just didn't like the place I worked. I didn't really like the kind of work I was doing. It just wasn't very satisfying. And so I quit my job and I ended up working for Philip for like 2 years as his assistant and studio manager. Yeah. So it was cool. I was real green going into it. I'd never seen a view camera, never loaded a film back or 4x5 or any of that. It was all completely new when I started working for him. It was cool though. He was in this transition phase. So he was shooting film. Mm-hmm. And then scanning it on a drum scanner and Photoshop. So I really started working for him at an ideal time to get into photography.
Let's back up just a little bit there. You brought up something that I think is kind of interesting. There seems to be just this complete lack of knowledge in the population generally as to how architectural photography actually gets done. Mm-hmm. It's not taught in schools generally. And if it is, the business side of it is not ever taught in schools.
For sure.
And so people come out not really understanding that in order to do this job, you're going to have to be self-employed and you're going to probably have to start out assisting someone who knows how to do it.
Yeah.
Because you don't come out really having those skills. So it's an interesting niche. And you mentioned that you went to work for Philip for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. That really is the most common way that, you know, we did a poll with the AIP, about 90% said that that's how they'd started, is by assisting another photographer. Philip was kind of at that hybrid stage, it sounds like, where film was still being used and we were trying to figure out a way to get it in a digital format to people. Macintosh computers were coming into design studios and advertising agencies and things like that. And so that was an interesting time. I'm assuming that you probably worked mostly with 4x5 with Philip then at that time.
It kind of depended. He did a lot of 120 for his local clients. And then when he had a more national, you know, advertising job, we would shoot 4x5.
Okay.
So it just sort of depended on the needs of the clients, but we were drum scanning everything. So we had control. When he didn't have control, he would deliver 4x5 typically.
Yeah. Those days of delivering originals is kind of scary.
Yeah. You can't imagine.
So when you jumped to shooting on your own, about when was that? About what year?
It was about, I started working for Philip in 2001. So it must've been like 2003, 2004. Okay. Is when I started, and when I stopped working for him full time, and I went to he just hired me as a freelancer. Okay. Assistant once in a while, but he actually helped me get my first clients. It was a real estate firm in Charlottesville called McLean Faulkner. And so I started off just shooting the three exteriors that they needed for a listing. And and I was shooting film in the beginning too. So I had a 35 millimeter camera, and then I was scanning it. I think like the Nikon Cool Scan. Do you remember those little film scanners?
Oh, I do. Yeah.
Yeah. So I would shoot film, I would shoot slide film, scan it on that, and then deliver the scans. And I started shooting for real estate clients. And then I started working for the newspaper a little bit, the weekly paper there in Charlottesville.
Okay.
I didn't know if I wanted to shoot architecture in the beginning. Like it was sort of like I was exposed to it. And so I knew the process. I knew, you know, working for Philip, I really learned the whole life cycle, like, you know, what you need to bring to a shoot, you know, what you do at the shoot and what you do after, that whole, you know, three-step process.
Okay.
And then I was thinking that I would be more like a commercial, like I was really into music, and so I was shooting bands, and, you know, I really wanted to kind of be rock and roll photographer, but
sure.
I kind of just did a little bit of everything for the first, I'd say, you know, 5-10 years of my career. It was kind of this mix of architecture, people. I shot food for a little while. I tried product in studio. You know, I kind of just dabbled with everything. And then in the last 10 years, the last half of my career, it's been really focused on, you know, architecture. Okay. Actually, I would say the last 8, sorry.
Okay. That seems to be kind of a common path for a lot of people, too, is that they start out doing a lot of things, general commercial photography.
Yeah.
And then kind of work into that niche, either because they don't like being in the studio, or they they don't like, you know, being hunched over a camera shooting products all day or something like that.
Yeah,
that's interesting.
Yeah, for me, I just got tired of photographing people who didn't want to be photographed. You know, the environmental portraits. I just it's brutal. Buildings are much they're much more, you know, happy to be there and sit there and wait for you to take the picture.
I hear that. Almost everybody says that. That's going into architecture. So that's interesting that you say that too. What was your transition from film to digital like, and how did that process play out for you?
It was, you know, I was always scanning. So, you know, I had the experience of Photoshop from my web design days. And so I was pretty comfortable going into it. You know, I would say when my first digital camera was a Fuji S2, it was like a, I liked the files, but the camera was really buggy. Mm-hmm. And then Canon came out with their 10D, I think. And then that was the camera. That was the one that really sort of made everything a lot easier for me to switch to digital. So I bought like a wide angle lens and a zoom lens from KDH, and that was my main kit for the first couple of years.
Okay.
And then, so I've just stuck with Canon ever since. And as I've gotten further in my career, you know, the Canon cameras have kept improving, and they came out with those great tilt shift lenses. And so, I've pretty much stayed with the whole Adobe's Canon package for most of my job. And then recently, I would say the last 5 years, I've been shooting for my commercial clients, I shoot for Hunter Douglas, which is a big window blind company.
Yeah, true.
I've been renting have you heard of the APA camera system?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So I've been renting that with a phase 1 back, and which is super fun because it's like a traditional architectural camera with movements and everything. And it's a lot slower process, but the quality is phenomenal. And, for the right client, it's the right tool.
Yeah. I think I agree with that. If you've got a client who's got the patience to let you do something like that, the result is well worth the trouble.
Yeah.
And to me, it seems so much like shooting, you know, with a big CNR camera or something like that.
Totally.
It's about the same speed.
Yep.
But one nice thing is that it's a whole lot easier to judge what you're getting and how quickly you're getting it, and client approval and things like that. So
Yeah.
That's one huge advantage of it to me.
Yeah, I think the biggest, the best change in digital photography was when we could start shooting with live view and tethered.
Yeah.
That made my, like what I was doing the night and day, just being able to get real-time feedback of, mm-hmm. you know, the scene, to be able to sit with the client in front of a laptop and see the staging and the, you know, the angle move in real time. That was a huge game changer. So I'm really, I don't think I would ever go not back to not having that.
Imagine. that would be really difficult. So most of your shoots, do you have a client present with you, or are you shooting alone?
I try to, also on my shoots, I always bring a photo assistant. Mm-hmm. On the bigger jobs, you know, we'll have producers and, you know, digital techs and a lot more people, but I like working with the client when I can, just because I feel, you know, the photos are supposed to serve their needs, you know, not necessarily mine. And so I want to make sure that they're happy with the shots as we go, mm-hmm. and they have their input. And I really look at the shoots I do for architects as like a collaborative process.
Yeah.
It's not always possible, but, I have a tendency to overshoot or, you know, second guess myself a little bit when I'm shooting by myself. And I just you get like a site plan with some arrows and you're like, okay, I'll see if I can find this angle you're thinking of. So I really like having the clients there.
That makes sense. Yeah. I get those site plans too.
Yeah.
And usually may never even meet the client ever.
Yeah. So that I get, you know, jobs where we just do it all through email. I never even have a phone call with the client. So it's just, it's just a different world.
That's interesting. And are you tethered for most of the work that you do, or do you ever shoot without a tether?
I would say 99% of the time I'm tethered. And so I bring external batteries for outside for long periods of time. I've tried the wireless to an iPad, but I liked everything going into the laptop just so that ingestion later and editing later is all kind of seamless. Every once in a great while I'll have to like shoot untethered for some reason, but it's really rare.
Okay. I noticed on your website that you do a lot of shots that include people in the shots. Mm-hmm. And that's something that there's kind of a division in the industry about right now.
Yeah.
Probably more with photographers than with architects. Those that are happy to put people in the shots and those that just don't want to even deal with that. And
so
what's your approach to adding people in a shot? How do you, you know, what are the steps that you go through to make that actually work?
So it, you know, kind of depends on the client. So, but I would say like a typical job where we would need people would be like a school, like a mm-hmm. sort of an educational, you know, kind of setting. And so a lot of times I will work with the client and I'll kind of lean on the client to coordinate people being there. If they want me to bring people, then I kind of add production days for that, pre-production days. Yeah. So once we get the people there, then and I think having people in a space is one of my sort of strong like niches. Like I kind of know where to place people.
Yeah.
And so I try to place people in a way that makes sense for the scene, that, you know, feels natural. Mm-hmm. There's some movement or there's some energy through it. It's activating the space and making it feel very lifelike. It does complicate shots. You know, I try to be sort of a get it in camera kind of shooter. So I don't do a lot of like fancy lighting tricks or like, mm-hmm. you know, popping strobes in the different spots of the room and then photoshopping it together later. And so because I don't have that technique, I can put people in the shots pretty easily.
Okay.
And it depends. Like sometimes if we're like in a public space where there's people going to be in it no matter what, then you just do the best you can. But if I have control, I'll usually try to shoot the scene empty first, mm-hmm. and, you know, get the brackets and the, you know, the window plates that I would need later.
Right.
And then start adding people, into the shot. And then so I retouch, you know, the shot without people. And then I kind of paint the people in where we need them.
I think that's probably the most common approach that people mm-hmm. are using now and seems to be the most successful. Certainly the easiest on the people that are waiting around.
Yeah, for sure.
You can get those plates ahead of time and then just place people beyond that. And it's interesting that you say about getting it in the camera.
Yeah.
That's a real film discipline kind of thing.
Yeah.
You didn't have the choice.
Right.
And so in my conversation I had with Brian Dressler, we were reminiscing about, you know, changing filter packs on a single sheet of film,
yeah,
and varying exposures and all that kind of stuff, which we don't miss in the least. But it is nice to have that capability that you can, you know, get the space right, mm-hmm, like you've said, and then place the people. And sometimes, you know, the people just don't work out where you thought they needed to be. And mm-hmm, and it's nice to have that flexibility. Talk to me a little bit about lighting. I see from your website, it looks, and then the picture I saw with your carry-on truck, mm-hmm, it looks like you carry lighting. Mm-hmm. You are a lighting guy. So there seems to be two schools of thought about that right now, about whether or not we light or we don't light. You obviously light, and I'm just wondering what your approach is to most spaces for your lighting.
Yeah. So I try to make, I try to make the lighting look organic and real. I don't really like to overlight things. And I usually take the available light as the sort of the inspiration, and mm-hmm, then add fill to, you know, just kind of fill in the shadows or fill in problems that the natural light's not giving us. So I try to be as much available light as possible, mm-hmm, whether it's daylight or incandescent. I just try to use what's there. So that way, you know, I deliver a photograph that is representative of the actual space rather than my own personal lighting style. So, I would say, you know, I typically, you know, because of the film background, I shoot everything at F16, and mm-hmm, then, you know, my fill light is always a stop or two under that. So you'll never notice my lights being the direct source unless it's like a hard light, you know, coming through a window or something like that.
Yeah. Well, that makes real sense. I think that's something that's important to discuss and to bring up, because I don't see that being something that people understand that are just coming into the business right now, having not been around a situation where you didn't have a choice with film but to bring up that shadow value.
Yeah.
And to control the highlights on that. And so you just brought lights as a matter of course. And so it's interesting to see that you're approaching it the way you are. Your stuff looks incredibly natural. I mean, your work is beautiful. Nobody can deny that. So nobody would say that's definitely lit.
Yeah.
I started shooting in the 80s when the style was kind of for overproduced lighting. Look at, you know, Architectural Digest or whatever from that era. The photographer did his own thing, regardless of what was really going on in the situation there in the home. So people ended up hiring on the basis of style of the photographer and the big light. And there were some people that were really well known for that. But that doesn't seem to be the case anymore. Do you ever shoot just completely natural, lights off in a situation?
Yeah, you know, if it's great light, I don't mess with it. You know, mm-hmm, I find like the big room shots, like if we're in a situation where there's just one window and there's only, mm-hmm, one direct light, that's when I'll use more lighting than less. Yeah. But if I have like a white interior with, you know, natural light all around, mm-hmm, I'll add very little light. You know, sometimes I like to put in just one small strobe just to kind of clean up the whites and just to kind of clean up the shadows. But I don't go there right away. You know, I kind of compose first, find, mm-hmm, the angle, see what the available light's doing, and then decide if we need to add lighting or anything. And another thing that I do with my lights is I really don't like direct light. I like big, soft, like, mm-hmm, indirect light. And so my typical strategy is to bounce like into a corner or off, mm-hmm, a white or card of some kind. And then I put a diffusion panel in front of that strobe. So you get a bounce through a diffusion. So it's like a giant softbox essentially, but it's super mobile. It's not like a big box that's going to get in your shot. Like you can kind of put these things sort of anywhere. So yeah, I do a lot of diffusion, put diffusion on windows to, mm-hmm, soften the light. I do. And then I shoot, you know, I typically blow out the windows when I shoot. I like that natural light flooding the room. And then I'll shoot plates to bring in the view later or bring in the still later.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. What's your workflow like when you shoot something? I mean, going from, you know, you've got the capture in the camera, and then what? And where do you go from there as far as your production?
So we shoot, you know, tethered using Canon's software, the AS utility. Mm-hmm. And then I have that go into a hot folder, which is automatically imported into Lightroom.
Okay.
So for every job that I do has a unique Lightroom catalog. That way I can just sort of isolate that one project that we're working on.
Okay.
And then so everything, it gets automatically ingested, you know, it gets metadata applied, file names renamed. I have like a default preset that I apply to every shot that comes in. It's just a little quick contrast and, you know, color treatment that sort of gives me a good starting point for whatever shot I'm working on.
Okay.
And then, you know, so that's during the shoot, we're ingesting things and we're making stars to, you know, find what are our plates and what are the selects that we want to show later. If there's people, you know, we'll kind of edit that later because there's usually not time to really do a good people edit. But if it's just the space, you know, we'll just do, okay, these are the angles that we like. Mm-hmm. When I shoot, I try not to do too many versions of the same shot.
Okay.
Like I try to find just the right shot. So I don't want to like give the client too many, like, well, three feet to the left, 3 feet to the right. Like just get the one that looks the best.
I think that's really important. People will wonder how many shots we ought to do of the room. And I say the same thing to them. There's really one best shot of this room. Mm-hmm. Anything else is just going to be an alternative. It's not necessarily going to be three best shots.
Right. Yeah. You don't want to make things redundant. You know, you want to tell the story of a space in the sort of like overall, like detail, medium, you know, kind of, you can do different pieces, but the hero shot is the hero for most places.
I think that's another, you know, film brain kind of thing that where you didn't really have the time to give that option because a shot may take 2 or 3 or 4 hours to do.
Yeah.
You don't want to do several of those. So I think that's great. So once you got everything in Lightroom, what happens?
So I typically will process proofs. So I'll just do color and contrast adjustments, and then I'll upload a gallery to the client so they can review the proofs. And then I charge per file delivered on the retouching side for a retouching fee. So I don't want to retouch something that the client doesn't want. So I always like to give them proofs first. And then let them have any sort of feedback. So once they have feedback, then me or my assistant will start doing all the retouching. You know, we work in Photoshop and, you know, we try to be non-destructive as possible. So we're always working in layers. Mm-hmm. And we'll bring in the layers for the windows. We'll retouch on a layer. So any kind of cloning or dust spotting that we need to do is done on a layer. Mm-hmm. Once they're done, then we flatten, we save it as a TIFF, and we upload the TIFFs to a gallery, and the client will get sort of one more like passover to see if we missed anything. Mm-hmm. But then usually it doesn't happen, and the client will then download the high-res TIFFs and away they go.
Okay. So when you charge a client, are you charging a basic creative fee and then a per delivered file fee as well?
I charge, so for architect, it's different for each kind of client, you know. For architecture clients, you know, especially the local, you know, regional kind of size clients, I charge a daily creative fee and then a usage fee per party for the project. So it's just like a flat, like, usage fee per party.
And do you have to know that? You have to know the number of parties going into that situation?
Yeah. I try to get that ahead of time during the estimate stage, you know, to find out how many parties you're going to be interested in, you know, because there's always this incentive to get more people in. You can split the production costs. Yeah. What I don't want to do is just charge like a big creative fee. I want to make it scalable. So, you know, so I try to have, but that's why I do a usage fee separate from the creative fee.
Okay.
And in most architecture jobs, you know, it's between 10 and 20 pictures, you know, that we're getting in a day.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, there's always anomalies to this, but, you know, you just kind of adjust for that. But that's my typical workflow. And then I also charge for capture, edit, and process. So I charge for that whole process of bringing the laptop, editing, and proofing. That's like a flat daily fee. And then we call it light retouching. So, you know, it's basic cleanup. It's anything that I would do on set that's part of my creative vision.
Okay.
I include that as a per shot retouching fee. I call it the master file fee. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, some shots don't require any Photoshop. They take 5 minutes to do, but then some will take like an hour and a half. So it all kind of depends. And when I can, I try to scout a job ahead of time so that I know if we're going to need additional retouching. So for example, if a client comes back and wants to remove telephone poles from an exterior, like that's a big job. And so we I usually work with an outside retoucher for that kind of stuff. And I just, get his quote and pass that on to the client.
Okay. All right. So anything beyond what you would do is then build it a custom.
Yeah, exactly. Anything above and beyond just basic cleanup and color. Mm-hmm.
And how often do you have a custom retouch? Is it something that happens very often? Or?
It's happening a little. I mean, I would say, 25 to 30% of the jobs we're doing some additional type of stuff. Right. Telephone. So I live in Portland now. And so there's telephone poles everywhere. And, the clients always want to get rid of those. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's easy. Sometimes it's really hard. We had to remove an electrical box. And so I had to it was huge, this big, electrical panel right in front of the building. And so we shot the shot and then we moved 20 feet down and then shot another shot. So we'd have source material.
Sure. Okay.
To clone out the electrical box that was there. So yeah, that's funny. Like a retouching, I think sometimes I do more than I should. I feel like I should. If it's getting into the heavy duty stuff, I sometimes take a little too much on. I think I need to I need to be better about being more upfront about this is going to cost more money because it's complicated and trying to explain that. So I need a better way of explaining that.
Okay. That's kind of a two-edged sword for photographers because part of the value that I think clients see in our work is the fact that we do those little extra things that they may not notice necessarily, but when they see the photograph, they know it's been done by somebody whose skills are beyond what they've normally been getting.
Right.
They can't really quantify it necessarily, but a lot of times it is that little extra retouch that we take to clean something up. And that's kind of a tough line to walk. I understand that. You've got a really beautiful website, and I noticed that you also include in there a section for photographers with some information on that. How did that come about?
So, I've been a photographer for 20 years now, and I'm trying to think where I want to go with the rest of my career. And one thing that I've been wanting to do is to be more of a resource for other photographers and kind of have more transparency. ASMP was a big part of my early career, and I had a good group of mentors there. So I've created this new coaching website called Photo Authentic. And it's like an online membership where people can ask me questions about commercial photography. I will review estimates. I'll help them edit their portfolios. And I'm starting to do online courses, like how to be a photographer and how to do your pricing and giving examples of estimates and all kinds of stuff. So I'm excited. I just started it last December.
Okay.
I've got 11 members, and I'm kind of trying to do more of that kind of work going forward, kind of as a good mix between my client work and then being a resource for other photographers.
I think that's amazing, and congratulations on that. That's something that is so valuable to beginning photographers.
Yeah.
Both you and I know that because there just aren't really good resources unless somebody's willing to, listen and talk to you about things. You have to actually find a mentor. Brian Dressler and I, when we spoke a couple of weeks ago, one of the things we talked about was the fact that this isn't like most professions where you can go get a degree and get an entry level job and start working and work your way up and things like that. But it's a craft that you actually have to have a mentor or somebody who's a master at to show you how to do it and to teach those things, because otherwise it's a lifetime of trial and error.
Exactly.
And we don't want to encourage that.
Yeah.
So I applaud you on that. I think that's great. Tell me how much does your website affect your new business that comes in?
Oh, it's huge. I would say it's the most important piece of marketing that I can do. Because I had a web design background, I was always ahead of the curve, maybe for my skill level as a photographer. And, in the last couple of years, I don't do my website anymore. But in the early days, having a good website got me work. It got me in, it got me clients. And I was very aware of search engine optimization early on.
Okay.
And then creating, traffic to my website through advertising and, all those, it's why I'm on AIAP is so that mm-hmm. I can get that referral. But, and I tell my students this, that your website is like, you want everything you do is all about getting people to your website and then making it really easy for them to know, like, and trust you quickly so that they're motivated to contact you and be like, oh, this is the person that I know that can do this job. So, I'm constantly refining my website and making mm-hmm. adjustments. And I can't stress how important it is to have a really good website and having basic things like having a contact form, having, your contact information on every page and even saying the word photography or studio. I had this experience once where I sort of dropped the whole like photo or studio thing from my branding.
Oh,
I had somebody call me, they're like, Are you an architect? And I was like, no, I take the pictures of the architecture.
Okay.
So, like little things like that, it's like,
yeah.
So yeah, having a really good website is really important.
Thanks for the explanation on that. Your contact form, I was really impressed by the way you have that set up and how effective that must be for you. Having a contact form came up in one of our previous Zoom meetings with the organization. And I could tell from the looks on people's faces that were on that call that most don't have a contact form.
Yeah.
And those that do, the only reason they have it there is because they don't want their email on there to have it scraped.
Yeah.
And so it's such an important tool. And I thought yours was just such an excellent example of how to get people there and gain that trust and confidence and then get them to spend money with you.
So, exactly. That's the goal.
That's the whole point of the situation. How much travel do you do throughout the country? Do you most of it in Portland area or are you just kind of all over the place?
I would say most of it's in Portland, Portland and California and Washington. So I'm mostly West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
I had moved back to Virginia in 2015 and I was living in Virginia for about 4 years and I was traveling a lot more then. I would say 50% of my work was travel. Mm-hmm. And I was in Charlottesville, which is a really small town. So it's, there just wasn't a lot to shoot there.
Yeah.
But being in Portland, when we moved here, like I didn't want to travel as much. And so I changed my marketing to focus locally. And to go after just architects, to stop kind of going after the bigger advertising kind of jobs.
Okay.
That involve a lot of travel. So I've been kind of intentional about, our situation here and what kind of work I want to do. And fortunately Portland and the Pacific Northwest in general, there is a lot of stuff to shoot here and there's some, really talented firms,
Absolutely.
Big national firms that are based here.
Yeah.
So it's worked out well.
A very active market. One of the things I wanted to ask you about was kind of what your marketing mix is like. I know you said your website is your primary vehicle, mm-hmm. but what else goes into that mix of marketing your photography?
Yeah. So I find email marketing to my own list. So I don't buy lists anymore. Mm-hmm. I just have my own list. So it's anybody that's been a client or been a lead is on my mailing list. And so I try to send at least a monthly newsletter and I try to like not just be, here's some pretty pictures. Like I try to have it, a little story, add a little story or add a little bit of humanity to it. Try to find some way to something for it to be helpful and useful. And it's amazing. Like every time I send one of those emails out, like I get 3 or 4 jobs. Like it's just the easiest way to remind people that you're there.
Yeah.
And to get their brain thinking, I should reach out to Lincoln for this shoot. So with social media, I have a kind of like a personal aversion to it. Was it Friendster? It was like one of the first social networks that came out and all my friends got on it. It was like before MySpace. And I had just started working for myself and like I was getting bombarded with messages and I was like, I don't have time for this. I work for myself. Yes. Like I don't. So from the early days, I've always been like very kind of wary of social media. I find it can be engaging. It can find some clients. I definitely have gotten some work from it. But for the amount of time and energy that you put into it, I don't see it being nearly as valuable as having a good website and a good email follow-up. You know, I've heard and listened to strategies for connecting on LinkedIn is a good way to doing it. You know, if you want to cold call and, you know, try to track down people to hire you, then yeah, you could do those strategies. But I find it, you know, a referral system is probably the best, you know, combination with a good website and a good email campaign. Because, you know, word of mouth is king as far as industry goes.
Absolutely. I appreciate that.
What I've noticed too with social media is that the most people that are interested in following me are other photographers. And so,
absolutely.
You know, it's like, so, which is great for my coaching business. So that now I have a way to, you know, talk to that community in a social media way. And so I've sort of shifted my focus on that. I actually split my social media account. So I have one that's just for the business. So it's just kind of like, I just use it as a portfolio channel. Sure.
Yeah.
And then I have one that's just me, and that's the actual, you know, the Lincoln Barbour, you know, Instagram is like my main thing. And that I kind of like no longer decided it had to be show my work. It could be whatever I wanted. So I'm experimenting with, you know, different types of posts and trying to like create engagement to kind of help people know that I'm there to help and be a part of their community. And then ultimately try to reach out to other photographers who need help with their business and see if I could help them that way as well.
I think that's great. I really applaud you for that. What has the last year been like for you business wise?
It was tough. You know, it was good and bad, you know, so, it was started off really strong at the beginning of 2020. And then when things shut down, I had booked a job with Hilton. I was going to shoot like a bunch. I was going to travel a bunch. I was going to shoot a bunch of their hotels. And we were supposed to leave on like March 4th. And then like literally like the next day, like everything got shut down. So that was a bummer. And, you know, I had a couple jobs that were up in the air that all got kind of shut down. So it went dark and quiet. And then there was not a lot of good information from our state on whether or not I could actually shoot. Like the whole like shelter in place thing. When I first read it, it sounded like if you weren't, you know, an essential worker, you don't go outside. And so, but then like some more clarity came around and I realized that as long as I followed social distancing practices and wore masks and, you know, hand sanitizer, ate outside, those kind of things, like I could still do the shoot. So I immediately, once I notified all my clients, be like, hey, we can do shoots. Like we just have to be careful. And this is the plan. So once people started feeling comfortable, things started opening up. But fortunately I have a long-term relationship with this real estate company and they have like 70 properties on the West Coast. And they were scrambling because they needed virtual tours done quickly for all their properties. So they reached out to me to help them kind of find a solution. And then once we settled on Matterport as a solution for them, I actually got the contract to scan all 70 of their properties. And it was too much for just me to do. So I at the time I had a studio manager and we were hiring contractors to fulfill this. And so it became this really nice job to have when it was really quiet. So pivoting a little bit and, you know, finding something other than just photography has been helpful. And so, spring was rough and then summer was kind of back to normal. You know, I had my big summer shoot for Hunter Douglas and then the fall everything was really going well. And then it just kind of the seasonality, it always kind of dips in January and February.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, that's kind of to be expected, I think, in this industry. You know, don't want to shoot when it's wintertime necessarily.
Yeah.
And sometimes they don't even want to plan to shoot.
No, I know.
So I completely understand that. Going forward, where do you think you'd like to be in another 10 years? Have you thought about that?
It's a good question. You know, I think with my photography career, you know, I'm sort of kind of in this, I've been wanting to like expand my services for architects. And so, you know, what the virtual tour taught me is that I don't have to shoot everything myself. And so it's kind of gotten me comfortable with that idea. So we're starting to add video. Like I have video people now that kind of help me out on some shoots. And I also, I partnered with a CGI company in the UK to offer, you know, architectural renderings.
Okay.
So that's starting to happen a little bit. So, you know, I'm kind of using my brand as this whole studio concept where we offer different types of architectural imaging services.
Okay.
So, you know, 10 years down the road, you know, it would be nice to bring on an associate photographer mm-hmm. where they're shooting stuff in the way that I would shoot stuff, but maybe it's just like a different tier, and that, where it's like I'm more shooting the bigger advertising work and then they're shooting the more local client architecture kind of stuff. Okay. So that's one direction, you know, if I kind of keep going with that. But the other direction, if the whole mentoring and, you know, online workshop type stuff starts taking off, then I could mm-hmm. see myself kind of pivoting away from shooting and more going kind of all in onto that sort of business where okay. it becomes more about helping photographers. So yeah, I'm kind of at this fork in the road a little bit, and it's hard to say where it's going to be in 10 years, but.
Yeah, I appreciate you kind of taking a look at that, at least what it might look like in your crystal ball.
Yeah.
I think that what you're talking about with the education of other photographers is such an important resource. Because there really isn't a lot out there right now.
No.
Academic programs, we can't endorse any of them personally. I mean, I can't anyway. I sat on the board of a photography school for a while and was allowed to go because I didn't agree with the direction that things were going. And there's just, you know, getting back to the fact that we talk about photographers being the resource for beginning photographers, there's just not a lot of that out there and a lot of that willingness to share that knowledge. And so I think what you're doing is excellent. And I can only see that growing. I understand from those who are in the camera equipment business and things like that, that business has never been better for the higher end gear that people are expecting to use. They've lost a job or they've wanted to make a leap to do this mm-hmm. photography work. And so they need a little bit of guidance to get to that first step there. And so I think maybe you've helped fill that gap a little bit. If you were asked to, you know, give some advice to somebody who was contemplating jumping into this business at this point, knowing what you know now, what are some just really fundamental things that people should know that probably they're not going to know otherwise? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, that's a good question. It certainly depends on where you are in your life. You know, I mm-hmm. say if you're young, you know, I would take every opportunity you can to get into photography. And so, you know, I wouldn't go out and just become a photographer. Like you don't want to quit your day job. You know, you don't really want to like be untethered and try to like make it work, because that's just a recipe for disaster. So, you know, for younger people, I would say, you know, assist, get involved with productions, try different types of photography, even if you don't think you'd want to do it, just so you get some experience and to see how different photographers work. It's kind of, I would say, you know, mindset and building your own character is really what's gotten me far in my career, you know, just being a good person to talk to and be a good person on set and being able to like, take your ego out of your productions and your shoots and just being a real partner with your clients. Like that will never not be needed, you know,
that's absolutely huge.
Yeah. So, you know, considering yourself a team member, with your people, I would say, you know, getting a diverse body of work is really important and kind of honing in on your craft, but mm-hmm. also studying up on business. You know, you need business skills just as much as you need photography skills to make it as a freelancer. You know, if you don't want to learn business, you know, you can find a job as a photographer somewhere. But if you want to, you know, have a long career and, you know, prosper and do well, you know, you set some intentions and some goals and you work towards them. You know, I went to an ASMP event once and they were talking about an ad campaign and they're like, you know, we had a budget of only $35,000 for this ad campaign. And it was like a picture of two guys carrying golf bags on a golf course. And I was like, I could do that. So I had this vision that I was like, I want to get to that point where I'm doing these kind of shoots. And, you know, it took 10 years, you know, of trying and, you know, working for, you know, very little to get the experience and just testing and, you know, and assisting, but, you know, I eventually got there. So, Yeah. And a lot of that, I think, is just character. You know, it's just you have to really kind of believe in yourself and kind of, you know, use some grit to get through the hard times when you just feel like you want to give up.
I appreciate that. That is such good advice. And I appreciate you outlining the need for really good business skills.
Mm-hmm.
I always thought that if I were to have created a photography school, that it would be liberal arts. So it was a little bit of everything. Mm-hmm. And then there was an emphasis on business.
Mm-hmm.
You can always learn photography after you graduate.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, the ideal course would have four parts. It would be marketing, sales, photography, and like administration, like how to pay bills and taxes and, the things that I take for granted now, but I've made so many mistakes with that stuff because I didn't know and didn't have the information.
So. I think we all have. I would like to put your information in the description of this video and podcast. Sure. So that we can put your website link and so people can go there. And if you wanted to, is your educational part, is that a separate link then? Is that a separate website? Okay.
Yeah, so that's photoauthentic.com.
Okay. Yeah. And I'll put that in the description as well. So
cool.
That we
Thank
direct
you.
People there. Lincoln, it's been a pleasure speaking with you today. You've given us just a wealth of information in a very short amount of time. And this is something that, to me, if I were starting out as a photographer, this would have been so incredibly valuable. I would have listened to it over and over and over again. And so, awesome. So thank you for your generosity in sharing your time with us today. We wish you all the success and we hope to talk to you again soon.
That sounds great. Anytime. Thanks, Alan.
Thank you. Uh-huh.
Alrighty. Bye.
This has been another episode of A Photographer's Life. If you've enjoyed this program, please let us know by liking this episode and subscribing to this channel. A Photographer's Life is brought to you by the Association of Independent Architectural Photographers. This episode is copyrighted and may not be used in full or in part without the written permission of the AIAP. Please join us again soon for another inside look at the world of professional architectural photography.